This is a life-changing message by the Reverend Sam Korankye Ankrah.
Bless you, King of Kings and King of Glory. You have always shown yourself. Show yourself one more time. Only those who have faith and the believers in the house, shout a big amen. Amen. God bless you. Please be seated. When 1 year ends and another shows up, it is time to take stock of your life and ask yourself, how far have I come? What have I done with this courtship that I have been in the last 6 years? Ask yourself, what mistakes have I committed previously that this year I need to do away with? Ask yourself, what things did I promise myself to achieve and I did not? And in my discussions with you, we will look at the subject, removing the old garment, removing the old identity, changing the old identity, and going for the new identity. Removing the old identity, go for the new identity. In order to leave a lasting impression on you, I have chosen Mark chapter 10, the story of Bartimaeus, for my foundation text. And in Mark chapter 10 and verse number 46, the Bible declares, "Now they came to Jericho. As he went out of Jericho," as Jesus went out of Jericho. And I am delighted to note that this visit by Jesus to Jericho was his last visit, and the miracle of Bartimaeus was probably the last before he entered into Jerusalem for the crucifixion. I prophesy that someone, even though you are the last to receive the grace for financial blessing, what you are about to receive will surpass everyone else ever in your family. Is somebody hearing the prophet? Oh, come on, stand and shout, "I receive it." Great multitude followed him, and then blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the roadside begging. I want you to note that the fact that his name has been mentioned means that he was not an ordinary blind man that lived, so therefore, people must not take notice of him. This blind Bartimaeus was one with exception, because his father, who is mentioned there, is said to be very well to do. So Bartimaeus came from a very good background. So the question now is, what happened? What is it that will put a man with such a renowned background on the street and reduce him to a pathetic beggar? Verse 47, "And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, 'Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me.' Then many warned him and shouted at him and said, 'Be quiet.' But he cried out the more, 'Son of David, have mercy on me.' So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying to him, 'Be of good cheer, rise, he is calling you.' And throwing away his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. So Jesus answered and said to him, 'What do you want me to do for you?'" The blind man, they knew his name. They've already told us his name is Bartimaeus. Why are they still describing him a blind man? Why can't they take that state and description away and put his real name there? But you notice that the Bible continues to call him the blind man because that was what his name became. I speak you the word of God. Any state that has caused people to give you a name rather than the original that God gave you, today is the beginning of that name leaving you. That name is about to be canceled. It will be canceled by the word of God. It will be canceled by the anointing in this house. It will be canceled by the power of the blood. It will be canceled by your faith. And your original name from God will come upon you. I'm talking to one person here today. And the blind man said, "Rabboni, that I may receive my sight." Then Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And throwing away his garment, they said to him, "Take cheer, be happy. The Master Jesus is calling you." The dress you wear will describe three areas of your life. Your garment, number one, shows the office you occupy. If you were a lawyer, you are dressed in a certain fashion. And once you get to the courtroom, it is very easy to identify who is the lawyer in the courtroom and who is the judge in the courtroom. If I enter into a courtroom, I don't need to ask. I'm looking for justice. You see her writing. As soon as I enter, something is on her head. When you enter into a hospital, you don't need to ask who is the nurse. The nurses are dressed in a certain way, and the doctors have some garment covering them. Number two, your garment also defines your class, the class you belong to. There are expensive watches, and there are cheap watches. There are expensive chains, and there are cheap ones. There are expensive linen, and there are cheap linen. There are expensive laces, and there are cheap laces. Suit, there is executive wool, and then there's the one mixed with cotton. Each person buys according to the class and the level of blessing and promotion. Your garment also defines the state in which you are. If you are in the mourning state, or you are in a joyful state, or you are in a mournful state, or you are in a joyous state, your dressing also shows. When you see somebody wearing black, you don't need to ask. The person is bereaved. And when you see Royal House Chapel members wearing white, it means that they have sensed that money is coming. Anybody wearing white, you must sense that a miracle is. When you see somebody wearing white, it means that some promotion is coming, some celebration is coming, some victory is coming. Who is this person here? Somebody say, "I'm celebrating." Oh, shout it and say, "I'm celebrating." Let the devil hear you and say, "I'm celebrating." So when you see a man who is named in the Bible, and the name of his father is also named, question, what is this man doing by the roadside? Here is, because that is a desert place with a lot of dust, so he must always cover his head. Have you seen any human being, everywhere you go, you carry your burdens before? When the devil reduces you to nothing, every day you go, you are carrying your burden, because everywhere you get, you must sleep. Son of man, he has no house. And people don't have time leading you always. So they've given you a white cane, and they have shown you a particular route that you must always pass when you are coming from your house. So you must find out that you are getting the steps. Human being born of God, created in the image of God, reduced to a beggar. And blind Bartimaeus sat by the roadside begging. And every beggar automatically becomes a singer. My brother, when I me come out for Jesus. Me patch up, mommy, be bring God what he, please give me some money. If you don't give me anything, I will not eat today. Do you know me? I'm Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, the rich man who used to live under the street there. Now, my name is Eradi Wokasa. Me, I won't you know. Me, not you know. Ebeye Hedi. And until Miss Rawaradi Kasa. Namakuma. Tommy Yemo. If you come to me and you ask me this question, I want to punish you, Pastor. Choose one. Do you want to be blind or deaf or dumb? I said, I don't want any of the three. Hey! His garment had defined his office as a beggar. When God did not create him to be a beggar, the wretched dressing has now put him by the roadside near the market. Number two, the garment now will define his state of life every day. Every day, he must be a second-grade citizen with no future and happiness and fulfillment. He must be at the mercy of people who will throw coins, and some will insult him. His garment had now defined the class of person that he must be for the rest of his life. What happened to this man? Recently, there is this man, he's been coming to church now, very active man. Then very early in his life, 38, 40 something, he saw that his eyes were closing by day. Eventually, he became blind. Guess what? His wife, at the time when the man was blind, that she must love and support the man, the woman started flirting with other men. And when the man caught her and then complained, she goes like this, but now you don't bring money and I have to take care of the 4 children. What do you want me to do? Blah, 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 blah. Eventually, she got pregnant with one of the men, walked out of the husband's house, got married to this man, and they have about 2 children. And the man is being taken care of today by the sons. What kind of curse can a person bring upon herself? Hey, to be a full gospel, Bible believing, born again, wedded wife, look at your children and forsake all of them. And go into, Jesus, that comfort is no comfort. It is hell. For there is a way that seemeth right unto man. You will not see it when the devil has blinded your eyes. You will not see it when your mind is seared with hot iron. But on the day of calamity, you will notice that you made a stupid decision. Here is a man reduced to nothing by dress, by state, by office. But I have just realized that this God that we serve, brother, he is not wicked. When the devil takes everything, at least he leaves you something little upon which you can build your faith to turn your life and your situation around. Oh, come on, believe me. God is not wicked. He leaves you something. This man, blind as he was, helpless as he was, at least his God-given potential of hearing was there. He just heard that day there was a little commotion on the market. And he knew that was not what happened every day. So then he asked, what is happening? And they said, don't you know, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of David is passing. Oh my God. He said, if I have ears and the devil has not been able to take my mouth and my voice, I will use my voice today. And then, come on. The man said, what is in Tietiemo? I said, today I go shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon me. Hey, everybody was chasing Jesus. He was still hearing the chaos. His eyes were gone. He said, I have ears. He said, what is happening here? They said, Jesus is passing. He said, how distant has he gone? They said, he's just moving. He's moving out. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon me. Cried. I want you to examine yourself critically. There is something that is left for you. The devil took everything. But there is something you may not respect and regard. But that's what God is going to use to turn your situation around. It's now up to you to pray and ask God, God, so what is left for me now? Open my eyes. Let me see what is left for me, Lord. 2 Kings chapter 4, the prophet's wife. The prophet had died. And the woman had borrowed and could not pay. And then the Jewish tradition is that if you cannot pay your debt, then you must sell something that you have. And then in those days was the practice of slavery. And so she must now sell her 2 sons to cancel off the debt. Oh, that was a serious thing. Her husband was gone. Her 2 sons were also going to go. What was it that was going to be left for her? Practically nothing. Life will now become meaningless. So this woman comes to the prophet Elisha and said, Prophet Elisha, my husband served your ministry. Now since he died, I have suffered many things now. I am about to lose my 2 sons. Sir, do something for me. Then Elisha asked, what is it that is left in your house? When the devil took everything, what was it that is left? And the woman just cast the man and said, I have 1 bottle of oil. He said, that's it. Go and borrow extra bottles from your friends. Borrow many. Take that oil and begin to pour it into the empty bottles. And the more you pour, the more God will fill the empty bottles. After that, go and sell the oil and become a specialist and a dealer in oil. Pay off your debt. Build a new house and live and prosper. For that woman, what was left for her was a bottle of oil. For David, whilst in the bush, the only thing that was left for him was his guitar and his worship. For blind Bartimaeus, what was left was his ear and his voice. He said, I will hear and I will shout. What is left for you? What do you have left? When God is going to change your situation, he begins, number one, by godly intervention. God must first come into the situation. How does he do it? In this case, God decided to use his God-given gift, which he had given to Bartimaeus. In this case, his ears. He heard and he differentiated that the noise I am hearing today is not the normal noise. Something is happening here. It was God. Number two, you need information. If your situation must change, you need information. You need to come out of ignorance. Here is what I am saying. If you are all human beings, classmates, in the same church, all Ghanaians have the same qualification, and somebody is ahead of you, somebody is making it and prospering, common sense must tell you he knows something you do not know. He has an information which you do not have. Period. Period. So what do you do now? Go for the information. Go for knowledge. How do you do? Ask questions. That was how Bartimaeus did it. When he heard the noise and then he saw that the whole market was chaotic and everybody was moving up and down, the next thing he asked, what is happening here today? He asked and he got the information. The information, Jesus is passing on this market. For lack of knowledge, my people perish. Will you start asking for information from today? Get information. Ask questions. I want a university degree. University degree will not come to you because you just want and you wish it. Know that there are people in the system who have the university degree. Go and talk to them. Let them show you how they acquired it. Get information. Get knowledge. Get understanding. Get wisdom. I want to make money in case of my father's funeral, in case of my mother's funeral, in case I have to pay school fees. If you want to set up your business, I want you to know that there are people who are doing well in the business you want. Ask questions. Ask information. Go for information. Stop sitting in your ignorance. I want to reduce weight. Some people have successfully reduced their weight. Go and talk to them and let them show you how you can reduce your weight and get your blood pressure under control and reduce your cholesterol level and live long and don't die and then blame the demons for killing you. Go for information. How can I improve my English? Come on. Don't you know and don't you see that friend of yours whom you came to this church with has improved in the English? Go and ask him what he did. Do the same. Don't you know that when you improve your English, your confidence level will rise? Don't you know? Don't you know that when you improve your English, you cannot teach and preach the Bible better? Don't you know? How can I drive? Fool, don't you see people driving? Don't you see? The Lord says, I should tell you, go and start asking how you learn how to drive because your car is coming fast. Ask questions. Number three. The Lord will use your competitors to promote you. The Lord will use your competitors to promote you. The Lord will use your competitors to promote you. They were shouting. The man was shouting, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy upon me. And then the people went like this, shut up. When better people are needing the attention of Jesus Christ, you blind man, shut up. Then he cried out, this is my day. Jesus, have mercy upon me. Then all of a sudden, Jesus stopped and said, somebody is calling me. They say, yeah, Jesus, I am calling. He said, no. Of all the voices here, there is the one that is penetrating my spirit because there is faith in that voice. Who is the one? Jesus. Jesus said, yes, he's him. Call him. Then the people who were competing for the attention of Jesus, who were now becoming opposition in his life, shut up They said to him, cheer up. He's calling you. Those who are fighting you will now sing your promotion and sing your praise. Cheer up, cheer up. It's okay. He's calling you. He's calling you. Your detractors will make the way for your promotion. Those who don't want to see your rise, they will be surprised to see you where they don't want you to be. Four reasons why people will oppose you and fight you. Number one, when they have the spirit of failure and no success. Whenever you see somebody discouraging you, the person is doing so because the person is born to fail and the person is not a success. And the spirit in him, he tries or she tries to impose it upon you. From today, you reject the spirit of failure. Am I talking to somebody in this place? Number two, the reason why they will compete with you and oppose you is because they are envious and they are jealous of you. That's a devil spirit of witchcraft. Anytime somebody is opposing you, no, because they have seen who you are going to become and what you are going to become. Start rejoicing when people are opposing you and go ahead and do the things that they are saying you cannot do. Somebody shout and say, I am restless. Number three, people will oppose you because they do not want you to take the leadership. They do not want you to take the leadership. When you have it, they have to look up to you and they don't want it. They want to be domineering. They want to dominate. But you are going to break the spirit of dominance and you will take over where they think you cannot take over. I am prophesying to one person here in this service. Hallelujah. Somebody shout and say, I am blessed. Somebody shout and say, I am blessed. And the reason why, number four, they will oppose you is that there are certain people who enjoy to see people suffer the way they suffer. There are people who naturally enjoy it when everybody is poor like them, when everybody is a failure like them. Those people, I am saying that they will be disappointed. Because the kind of blessing that I have heard that God is going to bless you, the kind of thing the anointing is going to do, your detractors and your competitors will be amazed and they will be surprised. I prophesy to you, whoever has cursed you that you will not make it, the curse is reversed today. Whoever, anybody sitting somewhere, thinking evil about you, praying that you do not succeed, I prophesy you will succeed and they will pay it to pain them. Are you hearing what I am saying? Those who think that you remain single forever, they are liars. You will be married on this altar. Oh, you didn't hear what I said. Those who think that you will not be fulfilling, oh, come on now. You can't stay here without being fulfilled. You can't hear such a word without being fulfilled. Your old garment is being removed. Your old identity is changing. The Lord is bringing you out of the roadside and is changing your office from a beggar to a giver. Is changing your office from a single to a married man and a married woman. Is changing your office from being an employee to be an employer. Receive this prophecy if you believe. Receive it again if you believe. Oh, come on, say, devil! Hear it and hear it again. Something is changing about me. I can say that the situation is changing. Somebody say, minister, say, brother, minister, brother. Do you feel that something is about to happen? I can feel it. I smell the thing. Something is about to happen. This year, I can say, I will be named in the Guinness Book of Records. Receive the dollar. Receive the pound. Receive the euro. Receive the business. Academic excellence. Let me have a celebration in this house. Listen, I'm not making noise. I have seen God change Royal House Chapel from nothing to where we are. And I am telling you, the same God who did it yesterday will do it and do it again. Who is the person receiving it?
Who is the person receiving it? Who is the person celebrating today? Can I have a celebration in the house?
I'm dedicating some buildings here right now. I'm dedicating some houses here right now. I'm pouring some oil upon some cars right now. Receive it! Receive it! Receive it! Me name say me so nimi haonyina o ebe. This is your prophetic song. I sense something is going to happen. I will not be ashamed. Every day I sing some songs. There is a particular line that ministers to me. Today, the part which is ministering to them, me name ring wasid. Me, I will never be ashamed. The man you married, there were some girls who wanted to marry the man, and because they didn't get him, they have never supported your wedding. But listen, the Lord will disappoint all of them. The Lord will disappoint all of them. Many ring guasira. Amen. Onyan kupo.
Open to me.
Yachurose.
Watrose.
Wasu. Obechi wuswa. When you call upon the Lord, he will hear you. When you cry, you will never be disgraced. You will never be ashamed. I prophesy to you. Hey, the Lord will put a smile on your face. He will put a song in your mouth. Amparo. Prophesy. Who knows, sir? Speak to somebody. Speak to somebody. Prophesy to somebody now. Yeah. Believe in God. Please be seated. Take heart, cheer. Your voice has penetrated. He is calling you. And the blind man, his eyes are not open. When they told him Jesus was calling you, he said, away with this garment that defines me as a beggar. Away with this burden. Away with this wretchedness. I don't need this anymore. And then he ran to Jesus. And then Jesus said, what do you want from me? He said, Rabboni, I want to see again. He had not received his miracle. And yet he was willing to do away with that which gave him comfort by the roadside. This is a new year. Some garments, you must offload some garments. Because God would not countenance those in the new year 2007. The hands of the Lord are not too short that they cannot save. Neither are his ears dull that he cannot hear. There is such the abundance of anointing in the house. The Lord says, put away some old identity. The way certain people know you does not measure the Christian faith. Put them away. Rabboni, I want to see again. I was not born blind. Something happened. Please restore my sight and change my office. Change my state. Change my class. Put me in another class. Here are some old garments that the Lord wants you to put away. Number one, put away the garment of bitterness and unforgiveness. People have wronged you and hurt you. Find a place in your heart to forgive them, because as long as there is pain and bitterness, it will be difficult for God to release your miracle. Pray that the Lord will take away that pain. Number two, put away the garment of sin. It's not because God cannot give you a husband. He wants to give you a husband, but there is already somebody in your life. So how does God give you your own? Put away the garment of sin, garment of fornication, the garment of gossip, the garment of stealing, the garment of lying. Here is what the Lord has taught me personally. The Lord has taught me that people who are born to be successful and bound and are success bound, they normally don't have time for gossip and you know, lying and things which do not bring profit. They don't have time. Watch them and see. Watch them. It's people who are failure bound who have time in talking about unnecessary things. This year, break away from that spirit. Join the serious minded people in this church. We who are going somewhere, do business with us. How can I get the managing director of a financial company to come and sit down here? Number three, start showing God now. Show him now what you will use money to do if he blesses you with money. Show him now in your little. Start paying your tithe and pay it regularly. Give offering and give good offering. It is a message to God that God, when you finally prosper me, in the same way I was faithful in the little, I'll be faithful in this abundance. Throw away the garment of procrastination. I'll pay my tithe when I get job. I'll pay my tithe when I get promoted. I'll pay it tomorrow. Procrastination is an evil spirit. It's a garment. Throw it away. Number four, throw away the garment of pride and humble yourself. If you don't know something, humble and ask and be taught. If the way you are doing it, you measure your productivity and you discover that the other person is doing it better, humble yourself and go and ask. Throw away the garment of pride. Let me tell you something. God loves wealthy people who are humble. God loves handsome people who do not use their handsomeness to manipulate other young girls, but they are humble in their handsomeness. God loves beautiful girls who use their beauty to serve God, who do not use their beauty to sell their bodies to men, but they use their beauties to serve God. God loves them. God loves wealthy people who are humble and serve God. You want God to promote you? Ask God for humility now. Put away the garment of pride. Because when you don't put and deal with this spirit of pride and the money comes, it will kill you. When you don't deal with the spirit of pride and you become a president, you will die. When you don't deal with the spirit of pride and God now gives you makes you a general overseer of a large church with beautiful guests, with money, you will mess up. Deal with the spirit of pride. It's a garment. Throw it away. Go for a new identity. Number five, throw the garment of womanizing. Because if you don't throw it away now when the money comes, you'll be messed up. As soon as money comes, you'll be attracted to all kinds of temptations. Deal with the spirit now. Number six, deal with the garment of indiscipline and acquire the spirit of self-discipline. Throw away the garment of indiscipline. Throw away the garment of indiscipline. God does not put you in a position of trust if you are not disciplined. How do you organize your time to be in office and to work and to lead and to go to this meeting and to have time for your wife and your kids and to supervise their homework and take them out and travel with them and have dinner with them and have lunch with them and go out with them and attend to other family business? If you are not disciplined, God will never bring you to the place of responsibility. Luke chapter 24, verse 25 and 26. Then he said unto them, O fools, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Verse 26. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Now this was Jesus speaking to two disciples after the third day of his resurrection. And then these disciples were walking on their way from one village to the other. And then they were confused, discussing about what had happened in town, how that some women had come to say that the Jesus Christ who was crucified 3 days back, he was resurrected and he was showing himself up. And the whole thing was confusing these disciples, and they were confused. All of a sudden, Jesus appeared and he said, what are you discussing? They said, come on now. Are you the only stranger here? Haven't you heard Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who was performing miracles recently, how that he was crucified, he died, we thought he was the one that was bringing us respite and salvation and deliverance. And some women are saying that he's resurrected. We don't know here. We don't know. Then Jesus said, oh, foolish ones and slow of heart. In other words, haven't you read the Old Testament? Haven't I taught you enough of what must happen to the Messiah, the Christ? And how that he must suffer these things before entering into his glory. Suffering now and acquiring self-discipline and saying no to certain passions is a kind of suffering now, but it will lead you into your glory and promotion tomorrow. If you cannot pay the price now, you cannot get the reward. It so happened that the situation of the blind Bartimaeus was not permanent. There was a day that Jesus was going to show up to change that situation. And when the opportunity came, Jesus, have mercy upon me. His days of suffering were about to be over. Who says that your days of suffering will not be over? Who says your days of glory will not come? Who says your days of promotion will not come? Who says that to you? Don't believe that person. Believe me, the prophet of God. Your day of glory, it's around the corner. It's so close. Here is the difference. Jesus is calling you. Jesus is calling you. Take heart. He is calling. Question. Have you noticed that everyone that had an encounter with Jesus was changed and transformed? Show me what change has taken place since you met Jesus. Show me. And the one that is here resisting your salvation, making mockery of the church, laughing at us. Show me, what can you do without Jesus? The one who has answers to the problems you have in your marriage, the one that has answers to your problem of sickness in your body, the one who has solution to the challenges of your business, the one who has a solution to the challenges of your unfulfilled and struggling life, he is calling you. Throw away the garment. Throw away anything that will slow your running to Jesus and meet him. Throw it away. Get rid of any group that slows you up. Get rid of any company that does not make you get to Jesus. He's calling you. I'm talking to you about Jesus Christ. The same yesterday, today, and forever. The Son of the living God. Who was and who is to come. I'm talking to you about Jesus Christ. The one whose blood can atone for the sin. I'm talking to you about Jesus Christ. At the mention of his name, the one whose name brings healing. I'm talking to you about Jesus. Ah, in my accident, all that I said was Jesus. That's all. And the car that was traveling at 120 kilometers. Heat. Smoke. Fire. I came out. And everybody came out. Jesus. I am talking to you about Jesus. I never had any foundation of success from anybody. Nobody left any legacy for me. born of 24, a member of 24 family, several wives. I was number 22, lived in the compound house. There was a time I, my mother and three sisters and one brother behind me slept in one single room. My mother would cook cassava and then do pepper and put zomi on it without fish. That was what we ate. If other people are preaching gospel which does not carry the power of Jesus, I am different. The gospel I am preaching, I did not inherit from anywhere. I had an encounter with Jesus. I know what the gospel has done in my life. I know what this Jesus has done. And I am preaching it with from practical experience. What I have seen and heard and known, that's what I am preaching to you, my sons. Jesus is calling you. He's calling you. Cheer up. Cheer up. He is calling. Cheer up. He is calling. Jesus. Jesus. He is calling you. I said in the first service, watch, look at me. Do I look like a stupid man? I am so intelligent. I can do any business and be successful. And I said, I can be a president and be an effective president. Because number one, my eye heart, I don't know how to say it in English. Two, I have wisdom. Three, I know how to get into people's hearts. I know how to win elections and vote. Easy. Listen, the old identity, put it off, put it away. Go for the new. For if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Your language, your attitude, the way you do things, let it go. Let it go. Oh, Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go. Taking me.
Taking me.
Oh,
from the miry clay,
set my feet upon the rock.
Now I know.
Oh, somebody say, I love you. Tell him now.
I love you.
Tell him also that you need him. Huh?
I need you.
Though my world may fall.
Though my world may fall.
I will never
let it go.
My Savior. Oh, I don't know, but it's my closest friend. I will worship you.
I will worship you.
To the very, 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 very,
very.
At the mention of his name, every knee shall bow. Jesus, let every knee bow.
Lover of my soul.
Let every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord.
Jesus,
lift up your hands and close your eyes.
I will never let it go.
Taking me. As you worship the Lord, the Holy Ghost is coming out. The anointing is coming. As we invoke the name of Jesus, things must happen. Change must take place.
Lord, I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let it go. Man, I'm a Savior.
Jesus! Lift up your voice and worship him now. You are coming out of the miry clay. You are coming out of darkness. You are coming out of sin. You are coming out of pride. You are coming out of the house of the devil. There is a miracle taking place now. Deliverance is happening. The Lord is setting you free. Receive your miracle. Come on, lift up your voice. My closest friend.
I will worship you until the very.
Sing it! Jesus! Jesus! You are the deliverer. There is a miracle taking place right now. And there is a release now. There is a release now. Close your eyes. Receive it now. Yeah. You set my feet upon the rock. Now I know. Now I know. Now I know. Oh, lift up your voice. Satan, I need you. Even when I follow. I will never. Oh, you are my safe, my closest friend. I will worship you, Lord. Until I will worship you until. It's a covenant. Say it again.
I will worship you until the very end.
Lift up your hands. At the mention of his name, he will stop and say, call him for me. At the mention of his name, he will say, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Somebody say, Jesus! 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 Have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me. Have mercy upon me. Jesus! Jesus! Hear my voice. Jesus! I am calling you. I need you. I need you. Oh, Jesus. Lift up your hands. You are going to say to the spirit of frustration and sickness and pain and setbacks. Say, I'm tired. Say it again, I'm tired. Jesus.
Come into my situation.
Now. Now.
Jesus.
Jesus! I don't know anybody who called Jesus like this and didn't have a change of identity. It was this same voice that touched Jesus and he stopped. He said, what do you want from me? Say, Jesus! If you ask me, what do you want from me? I know what I want.
I want
satisfaction.
I want fulfillment.
I want joy.
I want peace.
Change my situation.
Change my class.
Change my state.
I don't like this office.
It doesn't honor you.
I need a change.
A change. That sickness in your body is living now. It will never remain there again. That pain is leaving your breast. It's leaving your back. It's leaving you now. It's going. Touch it and say, go! 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 Jesus! If that sickness is not in you, but it's in your sister or your brother or your father or your uncle, Say sickness. In the name of Jesus. Go. Anyone that meets Jesus has a touch, a change, and a transformation. Now, change, change, change. Jesus. Something is happening here now. The glory of God is moving in this house. God is making a selection, and you are one of those that. One, take it now. Two, four, five, six. Say Jesus. Again.
Jesus.
For the last time.
Jesus.
Bartimaeus said it and it worked for him. I don't see why it should not work for me. Jesus!
Jesus!
This garment
is too heavy.
I don't want it.
No more.
Clap your hands. Say no more.
No more.
Garment.
No more.
No more. Financial difficulties.
No more.
No more.
Family problems.
No more.
No more.
Yes.
No more.
No more.
No more.
No more.
I cancel you
by the blood.
By the blood.
And in the name of Jesus.
No more.
No more.
No more.
No more.
No more.
Somebody say, anointing, fall upon me. Within the next 48 hours, let a remarkable something happen. I call it.
I
prophesy.
I pray
it.
I believe
it.
I declare it.
I say it.
Jesus!
Lift up your hands.
The Lord. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world.
It is our fervent prayer that this message will have an effect on your life and will lead you to the place where you belong. Royalhouse Chapel International, touching our generation with the power of God. God richly bless you.
Ancient words will guide.